Adedi Kakalo was Minister of Finance of the Federal Republic of Nigeria in 1986 and in 1994. Just recently, he expressed his concern on the current economic and political state of our country, Nigeria. Dr. Adedi Kakalo reviews the current economic situation of the country.
I think as an economist, we are very concerned. We enjoyed a long period of boom in which oil prices were at the highest levels, but we find ourselves now on the threshold of very low reserves, not necessarily in terms of the normal definition of 2 to 3 months of imports, but in terms of total capacity to take care of the demands of the economy. So the first thing is that these kinds of deep decline in commodity prices is normal, it's universal, and it's part of the whole cyclical change in the economy. But what has characterized our current difficulties is that we are not able to reach agreement as how to compensate for the heavy loss in terms of trade that has reduced our gross domestic product, government revenue, and so on and so forth. There are established procedures for immediately refinancing yourself out of the dip in your current receipts. And I think it is that loss of time, at least a year, we've lost a year in which we should have taken action. If we had taken action appropriately, my sense of it is that we would have been able to meet all our current demands, and specifically, our interest rate should have been going the other way. Probably we should be getting below 150 naira to a dollar instead of getting close to 500 a dollar. And of course, that means that with a substantial inflow of foreign capital at low interest costs, the average rate of interest will be lower, and the overall impact on the inflation will have been much, much, much lower. In fact, as I said, ideally, with the sheer support this administration came up with, we could have been just seeing the opposite of what we are seeing. Higher employment, lower prices, stable exchange rates, stable macroeconomy, large inflows of foreign investments and equity and loan capital, and speeding up of a growth rate. That is, we could have traversed the crest occasioned by the dip in the oil prices by now. So we have to move very quickly to get back to where we should have been a year ago.
Dr. Kalu further gives an analysis of how the country can step out of its economic crisis.
Well, I have just mentioned the solution is we identify all those things that we need to do. First is we need to access those funds that will go to meet the needs of the economy. And of course, the government is already taking some of the other actions to recover a lot of the monies that were wasted, that were looted, to correct the issues of corruption that's widespread in all sectors of the economy, at all levels of governance, to take the right macroeconomic policies, to put the right macroeconomic policies in place, such as liquidity control, capacity utilization of already existing capacity by addressing new credit to various small, medium, and long-term manufacturing, agricultural, and other other sectors. So essentially, what we need to do is to go back, optimize what is due to us from grants, from low credits, from medium and long-term debts that are in consonance with what's available at the World Bank, at the IMF, at the ADB, other institutions. And of course, government is thinking of, in addition, floating a bond in the Euro bond market, providing an enabling environment for investors to come in, making it very investment friendly by improving the very adverse environment. See what others have been doing that have put them in the forefront, and then try to dig ourselves out from where we are seen as not being an economy that's conducive to investors. We think we are, but in fact, we need to look at our rules and regulations and so on and so forth. So that's what we have to do very quickly. Go back to what we should have done a year and a few months ago.
Dr. Kalu also airs his view on the sales of national assets.
Well, I've expressed very strong opposition to it. First of all, you see, what we have a resource gap. A resource gap, you define it as accurately as possible. You see what you need to recover. As I listed so many things that we need to recover from the economy, sources of funding, to address that gap. Now, when you are actively doing this, you are doing the targeting a particular shortfall. But when you are talking about selling assets, first of all, it gives the impression that we are really more hard up than we really should be. Selling assets is auctioning, and these are oil and gas related assets. And we are doing this at a time when we are in a deep hole because of falling oil and gas prices, certainly oil prices. So first, you don't know what you are going to get, and you don't know when you are going to get it. So even from a purely quantitative standpoint, it's an inefficient way of filling that gap which have been identified. It's better you identify the gap and target your sources of borrowings, your sources of income, what you have to do, where you can be sure when you can access these funds. You get a disbursement schedule, you get arrivals schedule, you get the time when payments have to be made. So you are blocking your gap at the right time, whether it's in the first or second or third or last quarter or first quarter of the next budget year. So in terms of the need to be precise as to how you fill your gap, it is not by auctioning assets and hoping for the best. With all due respect, by the time you just put it on sale, you see that people know you are desperate. They take their time to price it and they offer you the worst payment that is more conducive to them than is more in consonance with your need to fill a gap within a budget year or within a two-year period. So from that standpoint, it's an inefficient thing. And secondly, it gives a wrong impression about our finances. I don't think Nigeria is so desperate as to be auctioning assets. Sure, if we want to reduce government holdings in oil and gas, like the US government, some of the advanced countries, they don't have any equities in oil and gas. It's all private sector driven. All they focus on is getting their royalties and rents and taxes and so on and so forth. It's the private sector that handles it. But the time you want to get rid of your portion of this is not in a time of emergency when you are going to be flinging it, as it were. And you end up suffering heavy losses, which will not be in the public interest. And I think that we are really not desperate. We are still in a position to wait until we can get the right profitable environment in which to dislodge these assets. So from that standpoint, I don't think that's what you should be doing.
What does Dr. Kalu have to say about the restructuring of Nigeria?
Well, I think, first of all, let me say that it is not the president or the National Assembly, except to the extent that they're expressing the will of the people. They are not the ones to say, we don't restructure, we don't want any change, we are good the way we are. It is for the people, through their accredited representatives, through their acknowledged spokespeople, who will say, hey, we don't like the way our constitution is. We don't like the way our structure is. We want to restructure, and the restructuring should be seen as not something to pull the country apart, but to strengthen our democracy and strengthen our form of governance. And I think that it is the right and the privilege of the people to say, yes, we want to change certain things. My personal view is that we are running a very heavy federal system. We borrowed it from the US, but we seem to have borrowed too much of the heavy spending and none of the appropriate representation. So I think that restructuring should be geared to what is going to be improving representation. For instance, I think we should go back to the, first of all, we have to make that basic decision. Are we prepared to stay together as one country? Are we prepared to begin to approximate a modern state. 50 years from now, we should abstract from ourselves and think about our children and our grandchildren, the kind of modern state they would like to have. In that modern state, we want a Nigeria where local governments can be restructured for development. So I want one thing I will offer for that is, I've thought about this for a long time, I've written and spoken about this. Restructure the local governments from about 740-something to about half that number, to a number that is manageable, where you can have a certain level of expertise in each local government that can undertake development projects, basic projects, health, education, rural development, roads, and so on and so forth, small-scale cottage industry, environmental sanitation, credit to farmers, gathering of produce in modern transport, and so on. So many activities that can be done at the local government level. And then we designate the population requirement for that local government to say between, say, 650,000 to 750,000. It can't be equal, but it will be more equal than what we have now. So if we restructure the population of about 200 million into local government of that size, the number will drop to less than half of what we have now. But they'll be more viable. They will have more expertise to run the local government as chairman, as councillors, and things of this sort. So there's a level of and of course those who constitute this population, wherever they come from, that becomes their local government. You solve this vexing problem of indigent people who are from this or from that. If you're in that local government, you can vote and you can be voted for. If you want to move away, you go to another local government where you want to go, and you undergo the same terms for being a citizen within that local government. So we'll be solving a lot of these ethnic issues. It will just be purely a development-oriented local government as a basis. Of course, people are still free to practice their own religion. They still have their customs and their languages and what have you. But from a governance standpoint, that would be a proper, viable unit of development. And then from there, we can decide, okay, maybe we don't want 36 states. We may reduce them to 25 or 30. From there, you can now get 5 or 6 regions, provinces, or zones, or what have you. And then, of course, we have the residual powers for that center, maybe Mint, Foreign Affairs, Defense, and things of this sort. So you have a modern state will emerge. 50 years from now, nobody will be the wiser as to what their state was and what. But of course, the states will be more or less what they are now, but we may have to drop about 5 or 6. And I think there is no reason why we are crying that so many are not viable and we want to still retain 36 states. We can reduce them to 30 or 25. But the basic starting point, the building block, should be that development stage of a local government in which all Nigerians who live there are equal, they have equal rights, they are equal citizens, and they have equal constitutional powers.
Dr. Kalu gives his take on the Office of the First Lady and Human Rights.
Well, those are two separate issues, but let me just take them together. You know, current issues, there's a lot of crescendo of a feeling rising that one of the problems we've had is proliferation of structures, particularly structures that are not necessarily contributing to development. Well, in time of dire resource needs, of course, people will be, nothing is sacrosanct. So people are not even talking about, one of the things we want to cut away is the sort of Office of First Lady, to the extent that it's contributing to being a drain. A recent official who was governor of one of the states said it costs about $2 million a month or something. I don't know whether he was talking about a month or whatever. Well, there are so many things we can do with that kind of money. Primary schools, secondary schools, health centers, credit to farmers, cleaning up the environment. And so there are so much we can do with that kind of money. But I also think that we don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater. You look back in the last 25 years, yes, there have been excesses in this so-called Office of the First Lady. But a few ideas have come up geared to addressing specific targets of the population, whether it's rural women or farmers or youths. You know, there could be projects really that could be handled under that position, but working with the ministry. So it's not like a distinct office of a first lady, but something that is specifically identified as part of the Ministry of Social Welfare, youth, women, youth, social welfare, but targeting particular aspects, maybe addressing the problem of widows, the problem of nursing mothers, the problem of underage students, or problem of the of a girl child. There are specific problems that keep arising in terms of some of specific cohorts of the population. Now, the other question of human rights, as I said earlier in my last statement on local governments, human rights are very important. I think no matter the height of development, no matter the rate of growth, it contributes to the welfare of the people, where they know that they're in their country, they have, that was why we were fighting for independence. I think the human rights was a basic target for independence. When you felt that you were owing allegiance to a foreign power, you are not really free to do this or do that. So it is paradoxical that after independence, we should be seeming to be having more problems with human rights. There should be, you know, there should be equality before the law. There should be a level playing field for all sorts of things. And you should have a habeas corpus that is over half a millennium, you know, where you have every right to speak your mind, go where you are, so long as you are within the law. Nobody can come and ask you to get out of the road. Nobody can arrest you for no reason. And if you are arrested, there should be a stipulated time within which you have to be charged for what you did or released. So these are all elements where you have your free speech and so on, within limits, within the limits of the law. And I think that it is very, very important. It's not just important to fill your belly, but you should also feel free as a person. So human rights are a concomitant aspect of development that we cannot sort of shortly over.
What is Dr. Kalu's assessment of the current ruling government of the country?
Well, you know, we are all very supportive of the need to tighten the structures of governance. You know, there was so much flamboyance in previous administrations. It's not just this last administration, in the previous ones. All this emergence of people, you see the populace is evidently suffering. There's rising unemployment, there's rising hunger, infrastructures, water, power are not working. And you see people who are just carrying on, particularly during the times of election, they're carrying on as if everything is just hunky-dory. So I think that this government has tried to quell it, but surprisingly, not as fully as one would have expected, given the fact that the merit of the leadership was that there was an austere leadership, disciplined leadership, no nonsense, straight arrow, and so on. So we want the government to keep to the hopes that it raised as far as flamboyance. And of course, we've already talked about excesses in expenditure, all the rumors about double dealing, all the rumors about nepotism, favoritism, in whatever guise, family, religious, tongue, state, zone, whatever. We want level playing ground for all Nigerians. We think the resources of the country are enough if properly managed, and that's what we are talking about, how they can save. And once they can save and they have viable projects, they should not be limited. They can borrow, provided it's being put into making sure that Nigerians are getting employment, they are getting power, they are getting all the other basic infrastructures, good roads, good rails, and so on and so forth. So I believe that the criticisms that have arisen have gone to the fact that, yes, if you come out with a plank of transparency, accountability, straight arrow governance, strict orderliness, adherence to the rule of law, judiciary that is above board, you know, and transparency in a very universal way, very actively, universally transparent. Those are the issues for debate. And all citizens, all groups, civic and otherwise, are entitled to continue to press that the government keeps its governance at that very high level that it said it would. And we should continue to watch and criticize constructively to make sure that that comes to be.